what the psilocybin did was it changed the behavior of human beings and consequently the way in which they met the natural selective processes in the environment was different. In other words, you could almost say they became a different creature through chemical modification, and that pushed them in a different direction. As to whether or not I dreamed this up on the natch or through the inspiration of psilocybin, I don't think I do much on the natch, actually. It's sort of hard for me to separate it out. I mean, these ideas come. You know, my relationship to ideas is entirely, I view them as something exterior to myself. I don't make them up. I hunt them. I encounter them. My image, this is just my image of the good psychedelic traveler. It's the image of a fisherman. And what you do in taking the psychedelic, it's the equivalent of rowing out on a dark ocean with your nets. And then you let your nets down. And then you wait. And that's a beautiful experience, to be alone on the moonlit sea with your net spread. If nothing more than that comes of it, it's worth the trip. But every once in a while, something will blunder into the nets. Well, you don't want minnows, like, you know, a five-hour meditation on why does your little finger just fit your nostril and the technological implications of that. On the other hand, you don't want Leviathan. You don't want to be pulled to the bottom of the sea by something so appalling and beyond your cognitive ability to process that it just leaves you like somebody in an H.P. Lovecraft short story, only able to gibber and weep in your locked cell. You don't want that. I mean, I'm very aware of this possibility. I know that if I took mushrooms, well, like in my home in Hawaii is a perfect example. If I took mushrooms every day or every other day, that within a very short time, I could become completely incomprehensible to other human beings. I mean, I could become the monk on Cold Mountain. So could you. Well, I mean, I could grow my eyebrows 3 feet long and live in a tree and chop wood and trade it to the peasants, and people would say of me, he's up there somewhere. We see him naked occasionally, leaping from crag to crag. He's enlightened, you know? The only cost is a complete break with anything familiar, anything human, anything human. This is me sitting in a hut in the upper Putumayo Basin of Camisari, Amazonas, Colombia, 1971, age 22, with graph paper in front of me. Jung felt that every individuation process would produce a totality symbol. And I think he also thought flying saucers were totality symbols generated by the psyche. And so it occurs to me that maybe he was, in a sense, too psychoanalytical in his approach, and that as we attain this individuation, nature speaks through each one of us and attempts to completely download its essence. And if the best you can do is draw a circle, that rests, that counts. Better would be to draw a circle with a cross in the middle. Better still, and you see where I'm leading, in other words, the more complex the totality symbol you can generate, the truer it is in some sense. So we could say that Newton's physics is a totality symbol generated out of his psyche and, in fact, truly reflects the movement of the planets and the stars. So one way of thinking of the time wave is it's simply a complex totality symbol generated out of a spectacularly peculiar individuation process that was triggered by psychedelic experimentation. The time wave is my best trick, and it's entirely mine. In other words, it's entirely the mushrooms, but it all came down through me. And it has many peculiar implications, but one thing nobody seems to have ever noticed is that it has really peculiar implications for the person who discovers it. Because it's sort of like, you know, Madame Curie was killed by radium because she discovered it, and in the act of discovering it was so involved with it that it took her life. Well, this isn't quite that simple, but to be the discoverer of the time wave, if it's true, is a very strange position to be in. Well, so then what I had at that point was about an 8-foot-long piece of graph paper covered by very fine lines in 8 colors on 3 levels with tiny crab-like labeling and hexagrams and this thing, which I used to carry around. And I would corner people in fast food restaurants, and I could take hold of roomfuls of people and basically hold them prisoner in a much less gentle way than I'm doing to you now. And, you know, my friends were having meetings on the subject of what is to be done. Because I would unroll this thing in front of people with a broad smile and say, you want to see a map of time? You want to see the future history of the world, the fall of Atlantis, Lincoln's hiccup? Here it is. And, you know, and I still have this thing. It's very interesting. The way I decided the endpoint was I had a notion of the last 2,000 years of history, of where the novelty was. In other words, I had a theory of history. I felt that the most novel periods were the 20th century, it seems obvious. Renaissance, the sciences, technologies, colonization, exploration. I'm not saying it's good or bad. I'm just saying that that was where the novelty breakthrough, another one came. And the other one was Plato's Athens, ancient Greece. Get this, there was a moment around 533 BC when Plato, Aristotle, Lao Tzu, Mencius, Ezekiel, Mahavira, the Jain prophet in India, and several other lesser luminaries could have all sat down and hoisted a beer together. In other words, they were all alive in this one moment. Anyway, you get the idea. There was this incredible clustering of brilliance, and it falls. I said that also has to fall in a novelty trough. So with just those 3 points, the 20th century, the Italian Renaissance, and 535 BC, I searched the wave. And then when I got a good fit, I would look at other things. The fall of Rome, the rise of the Maya, the just other things, with the idea that finer and finer things would be fitted when I got the right fit. And finally I got a fit so right that I could go right down to political events weeks old, and it all seemed to fit. So then I said, okay, this is, in my humble opinion, the best fit. And then I rushed to see where the end point was. Of course, anyone would. That was the big question. So now we've got the best fit. Now the biggest secret of all time will now be revealed by simply looking at the end of the wave. And it said, December 21st, 2012. Well, then it was pointed out to me that this is the end date of the 5,336-year calendrical round of the Maya. To the day. So then that was very both, well, it's hard to know what to make of something like that. The only thing I share in common with the Maya is that we both use mushrooms. Use, they did, I do. So then it raises a question almost of preposterous dimensions. It's like, if you take enough mushrooms, do you eventually get to a barcode which says, you know, download the following message before December 21st, 2012, local calendar time? And then why? And I've looked at why, and I must caution you, don't be a fool. In other words, my stance is not to pump this, not to prophesy the end of the world, not to claim the Maya came from the center of the galaxy, not to claim friendly extraterrestrials are going to save our chestnuts. I am very resistant of all of that. But I work with material which suggests that something peculiar is going on. Something called infinite novelty will arrive on December 22nd, 2012 AD at 7:18 Greenwich Mean Time.
Destruction program deactivated.